Hello, I'm Gian Andrea Rassati with the University of Cincinnati. Today I'm going to present a study on the shear lag effects in longitudinally welded connections subject to eccentricity. I would like to acknowledge my co-authors, Kenny Orlov, our former graduate student, and Jim Swanson and Tom Burns, my colleagues at the University of Cincinnati. First of all, let's actually frame the problem we're going to be focusing on. You see here in this figure a single angle connection that is welded to a gusset plate. Far away from the connection, we should expect a distribution of stress that's nearly uniform, which ultimately would cause a gross section yielding type of failure, allowing the connected element to fully develop its strength. Closer to the connection, we see a non-uniform stress distribution with peak of stress that are probably much larger than what we would see down the length of the element. This non-uniform distribution is due to a combination of in-plane effects. Centroid of section is not the same at the center of the group of weld. The welds are transferring forces just to the outside edges of the plate, and out-of-plane effects. In this case, the outstanding leg of the angle is not connected to the gusset plate, causing the non-uniform stress distribution. This non-uniform stress distribution can lead to net section fracture, preventing the connected element from developing its full capacity. The American Institute of Steel Construction requires the use of an effective area A sub B for calculations of net section fracture. A sub B is calculated as the product of a net area and a shear lag factor U. For bolted connection, the net area is the product of the thickness times the net width, and the net width is taken as the full width minus the width of the holes, minus some more material that may have been affected by the hole making process. For welded connections, which is what we're going to be focusing on today, the net area corresponds to the gross area if all sectional elements are connected and if there are no other erection holes. The shear lag factor U varies depending on the configuration of the connection and is provided in a table in the AISC specification. The Eurocode does recognize in part 1.1 the existence of the shear lag phenomenon, but refers immediately to part 1.5 for the calculation on an affected width. Part 1.5 focuses on plated members, and the focus on shear lag effect here is more along the lines of looking at the stress distribution within a cross section that is built up with the large plate members, so much more so than situations in the vicinity of a connection. The only explicit reference to shear lag for a connection is in part 1.8, which deals with single angle connections which are bolted to just one leg of the angle. In this case, reduction factors are provided that account for shear lag effects. In no instance, for the case of welded connections, there seem to be any explicit accounting in the Eurocode. Looking back to the AISC specification, the first time that a shear lag factor was provided was the 1986 edition of the specification. In 2005 and 2010, by then there was a large table that covered a bunch of different cases, including a case explicitly focusing on out-of-plane effects. You can see in this expression the variable X bar, which is the eccentricity between the connection and the centroid of the connected member, and a case that was focusing on in-plane effects. This was case 4 that has plates with longitudinal welds. This specification was examined by Pat Fortin and Bill Thornton in a paper that studied 175 historic data points on longitudinally welded tension members and compared the experimental shear lag factors to the predictions of the then current specification, which was the 2010 edition. This resulted in showing that the specification was unconservative in a lot of circumstances, possibly due to the combined effect of in-plane and out-of-plane behaviors. Fortin and Thornton set off to combine into a biplanar model the out-of-plane and the in-plane cases, case 2 and case 4, trying to improve the situation. The expression they proposed is shown here, and it has a component that has the out-of-plane influence, 1 minus x bar over L, and an in-plane shear lag factor, which was provided as discrete quantities depending on the configuration of the welds. Fortin and Thornton also worked on a mechanistic-based model, which ultimately was incorporated into the current AISC specification and will carry over into the 2022 specification coming out next year, that actually had an expression for the in-plane shear lag factor shown in this equation here, which was calculated as a continuous variable. This is where we come into play. Our goal was to actually validate the AISC shear lag factors by means of 20 unique specimens that we detailed. 8 of these were plate specimens that looked more into the influence of in-plane behavior, and 12 of these were angle specimens, which looked into out-of-plane and combined in-plane and out-of-plane behavior. The parameters for the analysis were the size of the weld and the length of the welds on each of the sides of the connected elements. The material that was specified for both plates and angles was A36, which is the preferred material for angles, which corresponds to a 250 megapascal material at yielding and 400 megapascal at failure. The welding consumables were matched as E70 electrodes, and the welds were designed to be developing the strength of the connected members, including a 1.1 factor accounting for overstrength in the material. However, by the time that everything was fabricated and we tested coupons from the specimens, the resulting average strengths were more than 20% larger in terms of yielding strength and more than 15% larger in terms of ultimate stress. Looking at our experimental data here, we can actually see the effect of the overstrengths in the welds. A large number of specimens failed in the welds, and that was due to the overstrength in the material that pushed failure to the welds, which was not supposed to happen. Correspondingly, the experimental shear leg factors we calculated are only lower bounds because the welds actually failed before the element. Looking more in detail into the experimental results, we can focus on plates. First of all the plates that did not fail in the weld result in an experimental shear leg factor of 0.92 to 0.96. We can compare specimens to each other. A2A and A2B were detailed to be identical to see if we can reproduce the results with some accuracy, and indeed that was the case. We can compare A1 and A3. A1 had 2 8-inch long welds, while A3 had identical 4-inch long welds, so 20 centimeters versus 10 centimeters long. We can see that the shorter weld specimen had a shear leg factor slightly lower, but that resulted in very similar results. So we can say that after some amount, the length of the weld does not have a lot of influence in these cases. And now we compare A1 to A5. A1 again had 2 identical 8-inch long welds. A5 had unbalanced welds, 1 8-inch long weld and 1 4-inch long weld on the other side. In this case, we have in-plane eccentricity, and this in-plane eccentricity did not result in any change in the behavior of this. So we can say that in-plane eccentricity in in-plane type of specimens is not very influential. Looking at angles, the only two that we can say anything specific about are the ones that did not fail in the welds. If we take these two and compare them to the identical weld configuration for the plate specimens, we can see that the experimental shear leg factor is very similar between the two groups, slightly lower for the angles, but more importantly, the failure mode is different. The angles failed in net section fracture due to the influence of the out-of-plane behavior that prevented those angles to develop their full strength. Instead, the plate specimens failed in gross section yielding, meaning that they actually were able to develop their strength. And the only difference between these specimens was the out-of-plane influence of the outstanding leg of the angle. We can look at the results some different way as well. We calculated the theoretical shear leg coefficients for the 2010 specification, Fortney and Thornton, and for the 2016 specification. And then we calculated shear leg coefficient ratios between the experimental and these theoretical predictions, resulting in a value greater than 1 for a conservative prediction and smaller than 1 for an unconservative prediction. If you look at 2016, we have 3 instances where the prediction is unconservative, although 1 is almost 1 and the other 2 are lower bounds that realistically would be a lot closer to unity if the welds hadn't failed. If we compare these to the 2010 specification, we see 13 cases where the prediction is unconservative. Not all of them are lower bounds. So this is what set off Fortney and Thornton to their study. In fact, their study was setting to improve the situation. Situation did not change at all for cases where the in-plane effect is dominant, but improved considerably when out-of-plane is dominating. And for the situations in which the prediction became conservative, maybe they went too far that way and became overly conservative. We compared this level of conservatism with the 2016 edition. We can see that the 2016 reduced the conservatism. It's still conservative, but much closer to unity, resulting in better predictions. Another way of looking at this is looking at the experimental results compared to the curves of the 2010 and 2016 specification. Red are the angles, blue are the are the plates. In this case, we can see that in 2010, for small L over W ratios, we would have unconservative prediction for the angles, conservative prediction for the plates, and the other way around for greater than greater values of L over W. In fast forward into 2016, we see much better predictions for both plates and angles. And again, keep in mind that these two values are lower bounds. They, in reality, they will be much closer to the predicted line up there. Finally, I would like to make some considerations, some comparison of Eurocode versus the American specification. So let's take a look at the two equations for net section fracture. The AISC equation contains a resistance factor of 0.75, corresponding roughly to the 1.25 partial safety coefficient of the Eurocode. Both of them have the ultimate strength, both of them have a net area. The AISC equation has a variable shear leg factor, the Eurocode has a fixed 0.9 factor. Also, we should mention that this 1.25 partial safety factor becomes 1.05 for section without holes. The Eurocode 3 equation has a constant 0.9 factor accounting for plasticity in the vicinity of the joint that never varies. So what we can do is divide the Eurocode by the AISC equation by the Eurocode equation, which results into this ratio here, which is a function of the shear leg factor. And the ratio becomes 0.875 in cases where you actually account for the sections without holes. But let's focus on the section with the holes. This tells us that the AISC predicts conservatively with respect to Eurocode 3 all the time when the shear leg factor is less than 0.96. Another way of looking at it is the Eurocode 3 is over-predicting the strength of material when the shear leg factor is problematic. And so that's something worth considering. Let's actually draw some conclusions here. Case 4 in the current specification provides the best prediction for longitudinally welded tension members. It's consistently accurate and is conservative without being overly conservative. The prediction is also very good for the cases where welds are shorter than the width of the connected element. We also saw that the influence of weld length and the influence of in-plane eccentricity are very small for cases where in-plane behavior is dominant and can be basically neglected. Looking at the comparison of AISC versus the Eurocode, the AISC will always predict a higher strength than the Eurocode when the shear leg is not an issue. Eurocode, on the other hand, will overpredict strength with respect to the AISC whenever the shear leg factor is less than 0.96, potentially by large amounts. The worst case scenario, when we experimentally had a factor of 0.57, the capacity predicted by the Eurocode will be approximately 70% larger than what AISC would predict. That's something maybe worth taking into consideration. With this, I thank you for your attention.